My dear students, this is your teacher ARD, and the topic of the day is final accounts for sole traders with adjustments. Final accounts means two things basically. One is income statement, which was also previously known as trading and profit and loss account, but the newer name in CAIs and in other accounting qualifications is income statement. And then we have a balance sheet, which the new name for which is statement of financial position. This question is tested by 40 marks question in 2019 CIE examinations for O levels. But after 2020 onwards, this question is tested by way of 20 marks question in CIE O levels. And in AS level, it can be tested for a 15 marks question or maybe a 30 marks question if you are lucky. Now let's discuss final account for sole traders. We'll be starting with income statement. First of all, you need to make a proper heading. If the heading is not already given in examination question, we'll be starting with the name of the owner, that is ARD traders in my case. Then income statement for the year ended, and the year end date will come here. Income statement is usually made in two columns. These two columns are not debit and credit. These are just made for presentation. We'll be starting with sales. Sales is also known as revenue. Sales or revenue means we have sold the goods for this much amount, whether on cash or whether on credit. It includes both cash and credit sales. Then after the sales, we'll be writing return inward, also known as sale return, but the newer term is used as return inward. Return inward means the amount of goods that are returned back by customers because there is a problem in the goods and the customer no longer need these goods or they are of wrong size, quality or specification, then we'll be deducting return inward. In an examination question, return inward can also be stated by goods returned by customers. If goods returned by customers is given, this is also known as return inward. If we deduct return inward from sales, we'll get the value of this. Technically, we do not write or label this value, but sometimes examiner previously used to write it as net sales. But in newer questions, 2018 onwards, examiner has stopped labeling this value, so therefore I am not labeling it as net sales. Then we'll leave a line just to make a neat presentation. Then we have second category, cost of sale. Cost of sale means the goods that we have sold for this much amount cost the business this amount. Cost of sales means the cost of the goods that we have sold. Cost of sale is calculated by starting with opening inventory. Opening inventory, the older name was for inventory was stock, but we'll be writing newer terms in CIEs, that is inventory. Opening inventory means the inventory that we had at 1st of January, in this case 1st January 2017. The closing inventory for last year, that is 2016, becomes opening inventory for this year. Then we'll be adding purchases. Purchases are the goods that we have purchased or bought for the business, whether they are on credit or whether they are on cash. All of the purchases come here. Then we add carriage inwards. Now basically we have two types of carriages. Carriage means transportation cost. One is inward and another one is outward. Inward means that we have bought goods from supplier, and to transport these goods from the supplier's factory maybe to our shop, the transport cost that we are incurring is known as carriage inward. Because carriage inward increases the value of our cost, therefore it is added. Means if I have bought goods worth 1,000 and I have paid 1,100,000 and I have paid 5,000 to my supplier to transport these goods to my premises, then the goods actually cost me 105,000. Therefore I am adding this carriage inward. Then I can also add custom duty. Custom duty also is mentioned in some of the questions. Custom duty, if I am importing goods from a foreign country, so my customs or taxation department actually stop these goods on the port, and the government asks for some payment so that I can release my goods from the custom. This is known as a custom duty. If I bought a motor vehicle from Japan that cost me 1 million in terms of park rupees, 10 lakhs, and the custom duty, the custom department of Pakistan charged 5 lakh as a duty, that car actually cost me 1.5 million, that is 15 lakh. So we'll be adding up the custom duty. Then return outward, if we are deducting return inward from sales, similarly we'll be deducting return outward from purchases. So return outward or purchase return or goods returned to suppliers basically means the same thing. Now we are returning the goods for the same reason that our customer returned goods to us. They are of wrong quality or size or color or specification, or we ordered it by mistake, therefore we are returning goods to our supplier and the supplier actually accepted those goods back. Then we are deducting the closing inventory. Why we are deducting closing inventory? Because these inventory is not actually sold in this year, it will be actually sold in 2018. So we'll be adding up it in 2018, but at the end of 17 we are deducting this. So after making all these plus minus, we will actually get cost of sale. Now we need to write two cost of sales. One is used as a heading here, less cost of sale, and the second is the final value of this cost of sale. If we deduct cost of sale from this net sale figure, we'll actually get a figure of gross profit. Now gross profit is not the actual profit, it is a profit, intermediary profit, which need to be adjusted for two other items. And now what are these two items? One is other income and another one is expenses. Other income means an income that is not part of day-to-day operations of the business, or any income that is not directly related to selling of goods. Now there can be anything that is labeled as received, whether it is discount received or commission received or rent received or rent receivable. These are all other income. Discount received, as you are aware, if you are paying our supplier earlier than promised, then we'll be getting a discount from our suppliers. Then commission received is also other income. Then it is rent received or rent receivable, it is also other income. Then reduction in provision for doubtful debt. If you have already studied the provision for doubtful debt topic, you may understand this. If the provision is decreased during the year, it is income for the business. And if the provision for doubtful debt is increased during the year, it is an expense for the business. If you do not understand these adjustments, I suggest you to kindly close this video, and first you may go through the lecture for bad and provision for doubtful debt in order to understand these adjustments. Then we have gain on disposal if you are selling some non-current asset for more than its book value. So it is a gain for the business. And if you are selling an asset, non-current asset, for less than its book value, then it is loss on disposal. So loss on disposal always comes in expenses category, and if it is, there is a gain on disposal, always comes in other income category. So these disposal entries and this calculation of gain and loss is included in a depreciation lecture. Depreciation, you may study this first, depreciation or accounting for non-current asset. Now we add all these other incomes. This is the total for other incomes, and maybe after gross profit we add these other income, we get another figure which has no name but still need to be calculated. Gross profit plus other income, then there is a no name figure. Then we have expenses. All of the expenses that are necessary to run the business are will come in this category, whether they are salary and wages, or whether they are rent, insurance, heat and light, electricity, sundry expense, depreciation. Depreciation is a reduction in the value of non-current asset. We need to calculate depreciation first, maybe by straight line method or reducing balance, or sometimes revaluation method. Then there is a discount allowed. Discount received is an other income for the business. Similarly, discount allowed is an expense for the business. Means if our customers are paying us early, we are supposed to give them some sort of discount. This is known as discount allowed. Then carriage outward is part of expenses, and carriage inward is part of cost of sale. Then we have bad debt expense, whether the bad debt has been written off during the year or it needs to be written off, whether the bad debt is included in the trial balance, that is list of balances, or whether the bad debt is included in notes and adjustment. Every time bad debt or irrecoverable debt, also known as irrecoverable debt, is always charged as an expense. Then we have loan interest, financial costs. How we need to calculate? We need to multiply by the loan amount by the percentage given in examination question, we get loan interest. If there is a 5% interest on a loan of 100,000, then we multiply 5% with 100,000, we get 5,000. Then repair and maintenance or any other expense, this is not exhaustive. There can be other expenses other than this. We need to add all these expenses in the second column, and that first of all gross profit, then add other income, then the no name figure, and then deduct these expenses from this. We'll get a final figure, profit or loss for the year. The previous term that the examiner used was net profit or net loss, but the newer term is profit for the year or loss for the year. If the final answer is positive, then it is profit for the year. And if the final term is negative, then this means there is a loss for the year. Then after income statement, we need to calculate, we need to create a statement of financial position, which was previously known as a balance sheet, but the newer term that the examiner is using according to IAS, International Accounting Standards, it's a statement of financial position. Again, we need to start up with the name of the trader, then statement of financial position, then asset. If the headings are already, most of the time headings are given in CI exam, if the headings are already given, you do not need to write the heading again. But if the heading is not given in the examination question, you can make a heading and you will be probably getting one mark for the heading if it is not already given in the exam. Now, if you remember, for income statement, we use the term for the year ended, and for statement of financial position, we'll be using the term as at. Now, it is not only an English language difference, there is basically the difference in concepts. Now, what is the difference? Income statement is made for one accounting period. It can be 1 year, it can be 1 month, it can be 6 months, it can be a quarter, that is 3 months. So, income statement is made for a specific period of time, but the statement of financial position is made at one date, means as at this, as at this. So, income statement is for the period or for the year, and balance sheet is for today. Means in balance sheet, we basically have three items, one assets, one then another liabilities, then we have capital. So in balance sheet, we say that we have this much of assets, this much of liabilities and this much of capital as of today, as of 31st December. But in income statement, this is not as of today, this is for a year. So I can also explain you by this. If someone asks me, sir, how much do you earn in 1 month or maybe in 1 year or one quarter? So what I will say, I will see you can look at and to onto my income statement, because my income statement states that how much I have earned in 1 month or maybe one session or one quarter. And if someone asks me, sir, what do you own right now? How much money do you have in your bank? Which car you drive and which property do you own? All of the assets and liabilities of mine will be reported in my statement of financial position, that is balance sheet. So statement of financial position is basically made in three columns. We'll be starting with assets. Statement of financial position is nothing but the accounting equation that you previously studied in your grade 9s maybe. Accounting equation is assets is equal to capital plus liability. Although there are different forms of accounting equation, there is a minus form also, assets minus liability is equal to capital. But the format that we'll be using will be assets is equal to capital plus liability. Starting with assets, there are two types of asset, non-current and current. We'll be starting with non-current asset. We need to make three columns, one for cost, then for accumulated depreciation, which is also known as provision for depreciation. Accumulated depreciation means total depreciation till date, total depreciation till now. Accumulated depreciation and net book value is the difference between these two. Cost minus accumulated is equal to net book value. Now we need to list all the assets. Usually these non-current assets are listed according to their life. Means land has unlimited life, indefinite life. Land does never depreciate. We'll be writing land first, then the building lasts lesser than land, but again it has greater life than equipment, then can be motor vehicle, then can be equipment. So this list is according to basically life. So in exam question, the examiner already lists these non-current asset according to life. So what you need to do, you just need to copy the values from the examination question in the sequence that are given in the examination question. Now these are the cost is the actual value that we paid for it and the actual amount that we paid for this. This is the original cost. Then we will be deducting accumulated depreciation. Although land does not depreciate, therefore it is a dash in here. For example, if the building costs 100,000 and the previous depreciation, accumulated depreciation, already given 10,000 in the question, and we all also depreciated 5,000 further in this year, then the accumulated depreciation is total 15,000. If we deduct 15,000 from 100,000, we'll be getting 85,000 net book value. Now, these cost and accumulated depreciation, we do not need the totals for these, but we need the total for this last column, that is net book value. We will adding up all these non-current assets. Then the second category is current asset. Current assets are assets that are used for less than a year, and non-current assets are assets that are used for more than a year. Current assets are temporary in nature and non-current assets are permanent in nature. Non-current assets are bought for use and current assets are usually bought for resale, such as inventory. So we'll be starting with inventory. Although it is although it's not written here, the closing inventory, we won't be writing closing inventory, but we will always take closing inventory, because this balance sheet is made at the end of the year. Therefore, we will be taking all the values for end of the year. Then we'll be writing inventory and all current assets in the second column. Why? Because we need to add this total and get to the third column. So we cannot jump from first column to third column, but we can easily move from second to third column. Then we have trade receivable, which was previously known as debtors, but the newer term is trade receivable. This is the total for trade receivable. We'll be deducting provision for doubtful debt. That is the total amount we need to calculate. If the trade receivable is 10,000, the provision rate is 5%. We'll be multiplying 5% with 10,000, we'll get 500. We deduct 500 from 10,000, we'll get 9,500. Then there are other receivables. Other receivable, basically two things come in other receivable. One is prepaid expense. As you may be aware of the prepaid and accrual topic, if you haven't gone through this, you may go through my lecture for accruals and prepayment. Expenses, if there are prepaid, means we have paid some expenses in advance. For example, if monthly rent is 10,000 and annual rent is 120,000, but we have paid rent for 15 months, that is 150,000, then the 30,000 extra rent that we have paid is an asset for the business, and it will be shown in the heading of other receivables under current assets heading. Then income accrued. Income accrued means we have provided services to someone, but we are yet receiving or expecting, we are yet expecting money from him. Therefore, it is an accrued income. We have given property, our property on rent to someone on rental basis, but the tenant has not yet paid us rent. So therefore, it is an income for the business. Then comes the bank, and then comes cash. So this sequence is also important. Current asset sequence is basically in the order of decreasing liquidity. Now, what does this mean? Means it takes... inventory takes the longest time to convert into cash, then debtors take lesser time than inventory, then other receivables take again lesser time than these two, and the bank and cash takes some further less time. So it takes no time to take out cash from the cash box or cash till or from our pocket. So these is the sequence for current asset. Now, if we add all these current assets, this is the total for current asset. If we add non-current asset and current asset, then the total is total assets. So this is the one side of accounting equation, or one side of statement of financial position, that is total assets. Now, as you are aware, in accounting equation, after assets comes capital and liability. Asset is equal to capital and liability. So this is not necessary. This heading is optional. You can skip this heading if you want. And then we'll moving to capital. Now, how do we need to calculate capital? First of all, we will be writing opening capital. The capital that is given in an examination question is always opening capital. Closing capital is never given in the exam. Closing capital is always need to be calculated. So opening capital is the capital that is given in the trial balance or maybe list of balance. Then we'll be adding profit for the year. Because profit increases our capital, we'll be adding it. And if there is a loss for the year, we'll be deducting it, because loss reduces our capital. And if there is some sort of drawing, we'll be always reducing our capital by the drawing, because drawing reduces our capital. So if we add profit and less drawing, we'll be getting closing capital. So we do not need to label it as a closing capital. It is understood that this value is a closing capital. Then we'll move forward to liabilities. As we first mentioned as we first written the non-current asset and then we mentioned current assets. Similarly, we'll first be writing non-current liability and then we'll be listing current liabilities. Then in non-current liabilities, we are basically loans, and if the loans need to be paid after more than 1 year, these are basically non-current liability. See, if you can see in this question, the year ends on December 2017. And if the date of the loan is given 2018, then the loan becomes a current liability. And if the loan is dated 2019 or later, then this loan is a non-current liability, as I have shown in here. And if there is no date given in the loan, the bank loan is always non-current liability unless the examiner states that it is a short-term loan. In that case, it will be treated as a current liability. Now, this 10% and this 2020 is compulsory to mention here. It is part of the name of the loan, that is 10% bank loan 2020. Means we need to repay the loan in the year 2020, and 10% means it is the interest that we need to pay every year. Okay, so this is a non-current liability. I have already mentioned it in the last column because I have only one loan. If there are more than one loan, I need to write in the second column and then add it to for the third column. Then, and last but not the least, there it is current liability. We'll be starting with trade payable. The previous term was creditors. Then bank overdraft. As you are aware, bank overdraft. What does this mean? This is a liability for the business. If we have taken out more money from the bank than we already have, then the excess amount that we have taken out from the money, although we cannot take out money without the bank's consent, if the bank allows us to borrow more than we own, then therefore the excess amount is known as overdraft. It is a liability of the business and needs to be paid as soon as possible. It is normally technically payable within 7 days. Whenever banks ask for it back, you have only 7 days time to repay this overdraft. Then there are other payables. There are basically two things. One is accrued expense. Accrued expense means expense that is incurred but not paid yet. If I have used my telephone bill at telephone or mobile phone and I have not yet paid my bill, then therefore is an accrued expense. If I have used the electricity but the bill has not yet been generated, then this need to be paid in the near future. It is a liability. Then there is a somewhat rare thing, that is prepaid income. Prepaid income means we have received the money that, but we have not yet provided services for that. If we have received rent in advance, but we have not provided our property to our tenant for rent. So therefore, the money that we have received in advance, it is an obligation, it is a burden for which we need to provide services in near future. Therefore, it is a liability for the business. If we add all these current liability, this is the total. Then in the last, we will be adding up everything that is capital, non-current liability and current liability. So this total capital liability should match with total assets. And if the total asset is always matched with total capital liability, means the question is done perfectly fine by you. So I hope you understood the concepts underlying final account for sole trader with adjustment, and you'll be better able to understand all these figures when we'll be solving a question, because if there are figures and amounts involved, it will always be easy for you to comprehend the values. So I hope you were able to understand this, and if you did, kindly do share this video with other friends and other accounting students. And if you're not yet subscribed to the channel, kindly do it at your earliest, and you can also press the bell icon and you should not miss any lecture from ARD. Thank you, G.